Hello, everybody. It's Tyrone the God 3 here, and welcome back to Fanfic Fridays. Or I don't even know what to call this anymore. I know I don't do all the fanfics exactly on Friday, and it's been a really long time since I did the Pokemon Universe fanfic reviews. And the reason of such was for several reasons. One, I stopped writing for a while. So yeah, that's a big thing, and I didn't want these to catch up to the actual writing. Two, a lot of Pokemon Sun and Moon news came out around this point, and also a lot of Dragon Ball Super news came out around this point, so I had to do videos on those before that news got old. So yeah, I had to postpone Pokemon Universe a bit, and I bet a lot of you all who are following me because of the Pokemon Universe stuff faithfully, first of all, thank you, you're really great fans. Second of all, I'm pretty sure you all are probably wondering, Ron, what are you going to do with Pokemon Universe when Sun and Moon comes out, since Pokemon Universe came out during the Kalos region? My plan is to do one of two things. One, I'm going to try to get done with Pokemon Universe before Sun and Moon comes out, which is probably going to be impossible. And two, I'll probably just release Sun and Moon stuff, like the Alola region Pokemon. They'll probably make like little appearances towards the end of Pokemon Universe just to show that I recognize that the Alola region exists. But I'm not going to just flat out throw them in there at last minute. That'd be kind of weird. But I will like try to seep them in, kind of like how in the Kanto region they had a few Johto Pokemon in there and stuff like that. So I will seep them into the Pokemon universe, even though the script for the universe has already been made up to level one, up to episode 100. But yeah, that's the plan. So I do have plans for all the way up to episode 100. I haven't made it to episode 100 yet, but I do have the plan, and it didn't involve Alola region Pokemon, but I can find a way to like kind of sneak them in there. But with all of that technical jargon out of the way, it's time for me to go ahead and do the review of episode 18, which I wrote a long time ago. It's called Tunnels of Separation, Luna versus Eevee. So, this episode begins with our heroes. After the Alden City tournament stuff, they're back on the road now. So yeah, it's been a while since they've been out of Alden Town. They're in Alden Town, and they're chilling on top of this hill, eating. Everybody's eating lunch. I don't know who cooks. Don't ask me. The scenes literally begin with them just eating. I think they all just sort of make their own food. It's basic lunch. It's not like cooked stuff. Anyway. They're all eating food, and Luna is feeding all of the Pokemon. She's the one that decided to feed all the Pokemon today. And it's funny, she even points out that Magnemite doesn't eat. It's kind of funny. She feeds all the Pokemon, and she's about to feed Eevee. Well, Eevee's not going to have any of that. She's about to feed Eevee, but when she's about to feed Eevee, turns her head completely away from Luna and runs to Trent's lap and snuggles Trent's lap. And she just won't have it. So she's confused as to why Eevee always acts this way. Even when Trent first caught her, Eevee would not get touched by anybody but Trent. But when Coda makes food, Eevee eats it. She doesn't exactly go to Coda to eat the food, but when Coda lays the food down, she at least goes to eat it. But when she tries to feed Eevee at all, Eevee just won't have it. So they're trying to figure that out for a while, and then Trent is like, whatever, I guess I'll have to feed Eevee. So when he goes to do that, they all look up in the air, and they see a bunch of Swablu and Altaria. Since Coda's very, like, awestruck by all these Swablu and Altaria that are flying in a flock that look like clouds, because, you know, Altaria and Swablu look like clouds, Coda's taking pictures of the Swablu and Altaria, and when the Altaria look down, they view this as a threat, because they see the camera. They don't know what a camera is, obviously they're Pokemon. So they kind of view it as a threat, and they end up getting mad and attacking Coda with Dragon Pulse. And Coda runs around to dodge the Dragon Pulse, but because of that, our heroes and their Pokemon end up running around, scrambling, trying to get away from the Dragon Pulse attacks. When all of the Dragon Pulse attacks hit the hill that they're on, it turns out that the hill that they were sitting on wasn't really a hill. They were on top of a cavern way to a tunnel. So since it's taken a bunch of Dragon Pulses and our heroes running on top of it, they all fall through the roof of the tunnel, and they end up getting separated by falling into several different holes in the tunnel ways. Because of this, they all end up in separate areas. Trent ends up with Pichu, Cyndaquil, and Taillow. Coda ends up with Magnemite. What else? Oh, he ends up with Magnemite, Katini, and Noctowl. Luna ends up with Misdreavus, Wooper, and, of course, Eevee. So, while they're all separated, Evie is kind of pissed off at the fact that she had to be separated with Luna. So Luna suggests that Evie and her work together just long enough so that they can find Coda and Trent. And Evie's not having any of that, so she tries to walk down a completely different road. Thankfully, Luna's Miss Drevis flies to where Evie is and talks with Evie long enough to convince her to work with them. So Evie doesn't really want to do it, but she sucks it up and walks with Luna and Wooper. Wooper ends up blasting Luna with a water gun just because it's happy to see Luna, and it laughs about it. So, yeah, Luna got the odd bunch. Coda winds up with Magnemite, which is cool because Magnemite can use Flash in order to guide its way through the tunnel. Tatini's a bit upset and nervous that it's not with Luna. It's a bit upset that it's not with Luna because it looks up to Luna a lot. Like, Luna and Tatini have a really close bond. So Tatini's a little bit upset, but Luna she's separated from Luna, but Coda calms it down. Noctowl, thankfully, has the ability to see in the tunnels because it's a nocturnal owl Pokemon, so it's using its visions in order to walk through the tunnels to help Coda and them get through safely. But when that happens, they also piss off a bunch of Zubats, and Coda ends up getting chased by a lot of them. Trent half, they end up using Cyndaquil's flame on its back in order to guide the way, and Pichu walks with Trent because, you know, it's no problem with Trent and Pichu, and Cyndaquil seems pretty level-headed too. Taylor, on the other hand, is freaking out because it's not with Coda, because Coda's hair on Coda's head is the equivalent to, like, its nest, and if it's not at its nest, it's freaking out. It's still a young Taylor, so he's freaking out. He's like, whoa, where's Coda? Where's Coda? And Trent, Cyndaquil, and Pichu trying to calm Taylor down, but they go through the cave as well. Then we cut back to our main trio with Luna, Evie, Wooper, and Mischievous. And while they're going there, Evie's stomach starts to growl. And Luna notices that Evie never got to eat because of that whole Swablu and Altaria fiasco from earlier. So she digs in her pocket and takes out a couple of berries to feed Evie. Evie does not want the berries at all. So she doesn't even try to take them. She looks completely away from them. Then we cut back to Coda, Noctowl, Magnemite, and Katini, and they end up getting attacked by some Golbats. Noctowl uses Air Cutter on a couple of the Golbats, and then Coda uses Magnemite's Thunder Shock in order to shock and scare away some of the Golbats as well. And then Noctowl uses Hypnosis to bring most of them to sleep, and Katini ends up using Grass Whistle to send some to sleep as well. So when they walk away, one of the Golbats actually is about to wake up, and Coda runs really fast to catch up with Noctowl, because Noctowl knows where to go. Then we cut back to Trent, Cyndaquil, and Pichu, and it seems that they've calmed Taylor down just enough so that they can travel safely. And when they do that, Pichu actually picks up some sparks of electricity in his cheeks. Since Pichu and Magnemite are both electric-type Pokemon, they can sense each other very close, so they're actually coming closer to each other. We cut back to Luna, Evie, Wooper, and Mischievous. And when we cut back to them, Luna hears that Evie's stomach is growling even further, more larger this time. And she offers up Evie some of the berries that she offered earlier. And she tries to convince Evie to eat the berries, and Evie then sucks it up, and she finally then decides to eat the berries that Luna were offering. But she eats it in a way to where it's like, yeah, I'll eat these, but I still don't like you type of way. Then after that, they keep traveling down the tunnel even further, and we cut to Coda's group, and Coda reads the map and discovers that they're in a place known as the Mineral Rock Tunnels. Once he learns that they're in the Mineral Rock Tunnels, he notices that there's very strong Pokemon known as Escadrill and Drillbur who dig through the tunnels and attack anybody who trespasses in these tunnels that aren't native to the tunnels. And while this scene is going on, before that scene happened, Luna fed Evie the berries, and when they walked off, you could see the shadow figure of Escadrill in the background burrowing from the tunnel as Luna, Evie, Wooper, and Mischievous walk off. So yeah, it's kind of just the foreshadowing that they exist. So Noctowl comes closer to finding them, Pichu comes closer to finding them, but Noctowl senses something wrong, and he changes direction from where he was going to go, which was the exit through the tunnel. And then Pichu senses something and goes a different direction as well. So while Luna, Wooper, Ms. Drevis, and Evie are traveling, Wooper then senses something by those little, like, antennas on the side of his face. And when he does, he ends up using water gun on Luna. He does the water gun on Luna only so they can knock Luna off her feet, because after he did, Luna falls on her back, Escadrille comes up and from underground where Luna was standing. So Wooper did the water gun just to get her out the way in time. So after that, Escadrille ends up attacking Luna, and when Escadrille ends up attacking Luna, Ms. Drevis ends up using Dark Pulse to knock Escadrille away. So then Escadrille tries to attack again, and when he tries to attack again, he ends up attacking Evie. And when he tries to attack Evie, Luna then comes in out of nowhere and blocks the slash attack and gets hit by the slash attack that Escadrille was going to use on Evie just to protect Evie. After that, Wooper ends up using Water Gun, and Ms. Drevis uses Dark Pulse to knock Escadrille away. Luna takes some heavy damage, and Evie is actually a little touched by the fact that Luna went all the way to protect her from getting hit by that slash. So after that, Evie feels like it needs to go ahead and help Luna because to return the favor, but she still doesn't really want to work with Luna, but she's sort of setting aside the differences right now in order to work with Luna instead of against Luna. So at this point, Luna, Wooper, Ms. Drevis, and Evie are all going to work together in order to fight off this Escadrille. Escadrille then summons up a couple of Drillbirds, and the Drillbirds come and attack Wooper and bring Wooper down for a couple of seconds. After that, it's just a battle between Ms. Drevis, Evie, and Luna versus the Escadrille. Escadrille ends up trying to attack Luna, and Evie ends up hitting Escadrille with Quick Attack. Then Escadrille quickly uses Slash Attack and counters back, and then uses Dig and ends up hitting Ms. Drevis. So Ms. Drevis is down for the count for a couple of seconds. Then afterwards, Escadrille tries to attack again, and Luna tells Evie to use Swift. So Evie uses Swift, and Escadrille counters with a rapid spin to knock the Swift stars away. Once he does that, Luna tells Evie to jump into the air and hit Escadrille basically at the top of his head, kind of like hitting the eye of a tornado. So Evie goes down to use Quick Attack, and then Ms. Drevis gets back up, and Luna tells Ms. Drevis to use Psybeam on Evie. So now the Psybeams hit Evie, and while it's hitting Evie, Evie combines the Psybeam with a Quick Attack to make a Psybeam Quick Attack, hits Escadrille right dead center on his head, and hits him hard. Then she tells Wooper to use Water Gun on the weakened Escadrille. Since Escadrille got hit with that heavy attack and ends up getting hit with a Water Gun, slamming against the tunnel wall, and it faints. The Drillbirds then attack Luna, Evie, Wooper, and Ms. Drevis, and there's too many of the Drillbirds in order to fight off after that big battle they just had with Escadrille. So while they're surrounded by Drillbirds and they're about to get attacked, Noctowl ends up hitting a bunch of the Drillbirds away with the air cutter. Then Cyndaquil comes in and hits a few with Flame Wheel, and we see that Trent, Cyndaquil, Pichu, and Magnemite, and basically the whole gang, Magnemite, all of them, Katini, Noctowl, all of them have caught up to Luna, Ms. Drevis, Wooper, and Evie at this point. They've all caught up. All of the Pokemon run to their respective trainers, and they're all happy to see them. And with the Drillbur and Escadrille knocked out, Trent and Coda try to figure out how exactly did they knock out Escadrille. And Luna states that it was all thanks to her working together with Evie and Ms. Drevis. And they were thinking that's impossible because Evie doesn't like Luna. So they were still kind of pondering over the fact that they worked so well together in that battle. But then afterwards, Noctowl goes ahead and uses his visions, his nocturnal vision again, in order to find the exit that it was going to go to in the first place. And he leads the way, so our heroes follow Noctowl out of the tunnel. And when they follow Noctowl out of the tunnel, they end up meeting this girl whose name is Corrine. And Corrine, she notices that she heard some rumbling inside the tunnel and wants to see, is anybody okay in here? Because she's an excavator. When she sees that our heroes came out of the tunnel after that big, huge thing with the Altaria and Swablu and them meeting back up together, it's nighttime, by the way, she's like, wow, okay. Our heroes look very hungry and tired, so she offers them a chance to stay at her lodge for the night and eat dinner, just to give them enough time to get ready to be back on the road the next day. So while they're all at her lodge eating dinner, Luna hands out dinner to all of the Pokemon again, Only this time, Evie actually does eat some food from the bowl that Luna had ready for Evie. And they all think of this as a shock. So then at that point, Luna tries to pet Evie. And when she tries to pet Evie, Evie moves her head away, runs away from Luna, and jumps back onto Trent's lap and snuggles against Trent. So that at that point, Corrine examines Evie a bit and is like really admired by how adorable Trent's Evie is. She tries to pet Evie, and Evie turns her head and moves away from Corrine. So at this point, Corrine looks at Evie and realizes, oh, okay, I get it. Evie has a Pokemon pet-like crush on Trent. And this is similar to how Ash's Chikorita had a crush on Ash. Same deal. So that's why she doesn't really like females a lot. Trent's Evie doesn't like females. That's a thing. But she does like Trent, obviously, because it's Trent. That's her trainer, and Trent saved her from the bug Pokemon way back in the capture. So, yeah, we learned that much, but Evie does look back at Luna and smiles a bit, then looks back at Trent and snuggles against Trent. So it seems that while she isn't, it's not complete, but the bond between Luna and Evie is a bit better than it was at the start of the episode. And with that said, then they all go to sleep. The next day happens, and our heroes are hitting the road because they're about to go, you know, to Zeon City. They're headed back on the road to Zeon City. And because of this, they all leave, and when they leave, the episode basically ends with them walking on the road. This episode was fun to make. I always wanted to make an episode involving Luna and Evie, specifically because of this little thing that I made during Evie's debut, where Evie didn't want to be touched by anybody but Trent, and specifically Luna, and I knew a rivalry between Luna and Evie was going to happen, and I wanted to go ahead and exploit that in an episode. And honestly, this episode, I guess you can say this episode was kind of like filler because no Pokemon learned anything new and they didn't capture any Pokemon or anything. But it was a character development episode for Luna and Evie, and I felt it was very necessary to make this episode. Also, I really love the idea of separating our heroes and their Pokemon and scrambling them up. It was fun to, do things where Trent had to handle having Cyndaquil and Pichu, which were perfectly fine, but having to deal with Coda's Taillow, who panics because he's not with Coda, because Coda's like a mother to Taillow because he hatched on Coda's head. So, yeah, I like making situations like that. And I love making the fact that the comic relief character actually had the easiest time getting through because he had the Pokemon that were equipped for going through caves. So, yeah, I thought that was a pretty cool use of Pokemon and character. Noctowl was a big star in this one. He was a silent but superstar in this episode because, you know, Noctowl's visions. It's pretty cool. So, the nocturnal vision because he's an owl and owls can see in the dark, obviously. So, yeah, I really love that the episode mainly focused on the trio of, the Misdreavus, Evie, and Wooper trio with Luna. Especially considering the fact that Wooper's always been, the comic relief Pokemon of the group anyway. So I felt that adding Wooper with Luna in the group would be bonus points to the already, struggling between Evie and Luna. And Misdreavus being a nice middle ground because Misdreavus and Luna are the closest in bond because Misdreavus is Luna's first Pokemon and it's the one that sticks by Luna the most. So I felt it was a good way to combine a strong bonded Pokemon with Luna to a Pokemon that doesn't really like Luna to a Pokemon that's comic relief and loves everybody but it has odd ways of doing what it does. So yeah, I really like that, and it was a nice way to introduce cave Pokemon and Altaria and Swablu. So yeah, you can pull that if you will out of the episode. Not every episode is going to be major plot development. I am a sucker for character development, so I feel like if a character gets something, they need the development in order to justify it. And from a lot of you fans, I hear a lot of you all say that you really like Luna's character, and I even told my friend who made the concept for Luna. She's the one who made the name for Luna and is inspired from, I made her as an inspiration of the character of my friend. So she does really appreciate the love you're giving her for her character. In fact, I think Luna's gotten more spotlight than Trent in terms of fan service, of fans liking her. So yeah, that's kind of cool, even though Trent's the character that I'm mostly based off of, or at least I like to reflect off of, because he's the main character. But Yeah, so it was good to make an episode revolving around Luna. As you all know, I'm not one to make episodes only about Trent, because Trent may be the main character, but he's not the only character. So, yeah, as a sucker for character development, I really liked the way this episode flowed. If there was one thing I could change, I wish I could make this episode a little bit longer. Typing and looking at the data now, it feels like the ending came kind of quick. But that was because I think I was in a rush at some point to get to episode 20. Because, yeah, there's obviously another episode, and that episode more or less revolves around Coda. And that episode is titled Episode 19, Take My Pictures, Coda, with Donna the Model. So, with that said, everybody, I'll see you all then, everybody. What did you think of Episode 18? What did you think of the relationship between Luna and Evie and their bond getting slightly better? While, yeah, they're not perfect, but it's gotten better, and I think progress is progress. So, with that said, I'll see you all then, everybody. Tyrone the God 3, out.